Welcome to Henry Ford Health Transplant, and thank you for choosing our team to care for your kidney transplant needs. I am Dean Kim, Surgical Director of the Kidney and Pancreas Transplant Program. Please write down any questions you may think of during this video. We are happy to answer any of your questions or discuss any topics further. The listing process sorts through your medical problems to assure that kidney transplant will benefit you. Some medical history will be gathered when you schedule your first appointment. At your appointment, you will learn more about the transplant process from a nurse coordinator. Next step is to meet with the clinical team members, including a transplant nephrologist, a social worker, a transplant surgeon, and a dietitian if indicated. Your transplant nurse will give you a list of required tests and appointments. You will need to work with your transplant nurse to complete these tests and have the results reviewed. Once all of your results are in order, your case will be discussed at our selection meeting where a decision will be made about your listing for transplant. Your nurse coordinator will discuss this decision with you. If listed, you will be seen annually by our team. Once listed, you are eligible for kidney transplant from either a living or a deceased donor. Living donor kidney is usually from a friend, a family member, or anyone who is willing to donate and is found to be healthy enough to donate. Your nurse coordinator can provide you with information on the website where living donors can sign up and be tested. There are several benefits for living donor kidney transplants. The living donor kidney is usually of good quality and lasts longer. A living donor kidney lasts on average 12 to 15 years, whereas a kidney from a deceased donor lasts on average 8 to 10 years. Living donor kidney transplants can happen earlier in the process rather than waiting years on dialysis, and is associated with fewer complications around the time of surgery. Living donor surgery is scheduled at an agreed upon time that's best for the donor and recipient. Well-matched recipients may need less anti-rejection medicine. Living donation also minimizes the chances of delayed function of the transplanted kidney. Finally, some living donor kidney transplants can be done with a robot, reducing the size and complications of the incision. A kidney's quality can be estimated by the Kidney Donor Profile Index, or KDPI. The KDPI can be used to estimate how long a transplanted kidney will last. The lower the KDPI, the longer the kidney is expected to last. Kidneys with low KDPI are usually offered first to children and young adults on the list. Higher KDPI kidneys, especially those with KDPI over 85, are usually offered to older recipients or those with diseases like diabetes, which make dialysis more difficult to tolerate long term. For recipients who are waiting for deceased donor transplant, you should see the kidney transplant team once yearly, or if you are older than the age of 70 years, twice yearly. This is important to update your social support, insurance, medical tests, medications, and review new issues. When we call you about a kidney transplant offer, we will ask a series of questions to see if anything has changed since the last time you were seen in our clinic. We will discuss if there is anything that you should know about the kidney prior to agreeing to proceed. All kidneys accepted for transplant can carry a risk of infection. This infection could be bacterial, viral, or less commonly from yeast or fungus. For example, if a donor is found to have a bacterial infection prior to donation, we may consult with our infectious disease colleagues and decide to accept the kidney for you despite the infection that is already present. We may choose to continue antibiotic therapy in you for a certain time. All kidneys are tested for viruses such as COVID-19, hepatitis, and HIV. One way to protect against infection is to be vaccinated for viruses prior to transplant. However, sometimes, despite our best testing of the donor kidney, infection can sneak through. For example, HIV or hepatitis can be transmitted with the organ about 1 in 7,000 cases. The risk is very low, but present. If a kidney donor is involved in behavior that would put them at a higher risk for transmitting a virus, for example, jail time or intravenous drug use, the risk of disease transmission for HIV or hepatitis would be between 1 in 100 to 1 in 4,000. You will be told if your donor falls into this category, and you will have the opportunity to accept this kidney or pass on this kidney. Regardless, all kidney transplant recipients are tested for HIV and hepatitis during the first year after transplant. You may opt to receive a kidney from a donor that has tested positive to have hepatitis C. The benefit is that you may be transplanted and off dialysis sooner. Hepatitis C is a virus that survives in your liver. Successful treatment for hepatitis C is available. If you choose to receive a kidney from a donor with hepatitis C, you will need to take extra medicines by mouth for 12 weeks. The rate of cure of hepatitis C with treatment is 95 to 100%. Delayed graft function occurs when the kidney is not working well enough to keep the recipient off dialysis. The transplanted kidney has been through a lot of stress, and it may take a few days to a few weeks for the kidney to regain its ability to filter and make urine. While the kidney is slow to function, you may need to be supported with hemodialysis. If needed, dialysis can be continued in your regular center or sometimes at home if that is where you were getting dialysis prior. If you were on peritoneal dialysis prior to transplant, you will need to be switched to hemodialysis. Delayed graft function occurs after transplant in 25 to 50% of patients, and a very small number of kidneys never work. This is called primary non-function and occurs only about 1 to 2% of the time. The important thing to remember is that delayed graft function is common and primary non-function is rare. Be patient. The vast majority of kidneys recover despite delayed function.
Hi, I'm Jason Denny. I'm the director of the Center for Living Donation. I'm also the surgical director of the Living Donor Kidney Transplant Program at Henry Ford Health. When you're called in for a kidney transplant, you will go to the 86th floor and be tested for COVID-19. If the COVID-19 testing is negative, you will proceed to the preoperative area, where you will meet your surgeon and anesthesia teams. There, you'll complete your pre-transplant testing. If you need dialysis, that can be done prior to transplant. The surgical team will check the transplant kidney in the operating room. If it looks okay and you look okay, you will proceed to the operating room for 4 to 6 hours. You will be given general anesthesia. The typical kidney transplant incision is near the right lower abdomen. During the operation, your native kidneys are not removed. A third or fourth kidney will be placed in the front of the stomach, usually on the right side. The native kidneys will continue to atrophy or shrink and get smaller over time. The surgeon will create an incision and find the blood vessels that run to and from your leg, as well as the bladder. The surgeon will implant the kidney. The kidney transplant can also be done with the assistance of a robot, which results in smaller wounds and reduced wound complications. There are three main connections made during the transplant of the kidney. The first and second surgical connections are between the transplant renal vein and artery and the iliac vein and artery. This returns blood flow to the transplant kidney. The ureter is a tube that carries the urine from the kidney. A third surgical connection is made between the transplant ureter and your bladder to drain any urine that the kidney produces. A drain is placed near the kidney to drain any fluids that collect around the kidney. We will be watching the amount and character of the drainage. We can remove the drain once we are happy with the quality and the amount is less than 100 milliliters in 24 hours. A stitch is placed over the drain site at the time of removal to prevent the drain site from leaking after the drain is removed. Sometimes it is necessary to send you home with your drain. In this case, you will be taught how to care for the drain and empty and record its output at home. If you are sent home with the drain, you will need to keep the site clean and dry. Often a stent is inserted between the ureter and the bladder. This stays for about 3 weeks while the surgical connection between the ureter and the bladder heals. A drain is left inside at the time of the surgery near this connection. The drain can help remove any excess fluid from the area around the new kidney transplant. Output from the drain can also help identify if there is a leak, a complication where the urine is leaking through the connection. This occurs in approximately 1 to 3% of patients. The stent is removed by cystoscopy, an outpatient procedure which does not require general anesthesia.
Hi, I'm Lauren Malinczak, a kidney and pancreas transplant surgeon, the director of H6, where you will stay as a transplant patient at Henry Ford. The Henry Ford transplant team consists of 8 transplant surgeons. Dr. Kim, Dr. Denny, and I do most of the kidney transplants. After surgery, most patients go to H6, the transplant surgery floor. The team there is very familiar with taking care of transplant patients. By day one, you'll be out of bed, at least to a chair. Your team will assess the function of the kidney transplant and need for dialysis every day. You may need an ultrasound. You will be able to drink if you're not nauseated. By day two, you'll be out of bed, walking, back to eating and drinking as you tolerate it. You and your support will learn about your medications for home. By day three, your catheter will be removed. After, you can urinate on your own. Your drain will be removed. Discharge plans will be finalized. While you're in the hospital, the clinical team will be watching for complications. These complications can be categorized as bleeding, thrombosis, infection, fluid collections, or problems with the ureter or bladder. In addition to getting infection from the kidney, patients can acquire infections in the hospital, such as pneumonia, blood, or wound infections. Bleeding complications can include bleeding from or around the kidney transplant. Blood transfusion is needed in about 20% of patients who undergo a kidney transplant, more so if you're starting the surgery with a low blood count. About 2 to 4% of patients will return to the operating room for bleeding complications. Those numbers can double if you need blood thinners such as warfarin or Plavix. We do not transplant deceased donor kidneys into patients taking medications such as Eliquis. Thrombosis is when blood clots. Blood can clot in or around the kidney, leading to loss of the kidney transplant in up to 4% of patients. If this occurs, the kidney would need to be removed and you would return to dialysis. You can also get blood clots in veins, such as your legs or pelvis, or in your lungs. This kind of blood clot would need to be treated with blood thinners. The best way to prevent blood clots in your legs is to wear the sequential compression devices while you are in bed, ambulate as soon as possible and frequently after surgery, and you will be given a blood thinner, heparin, under your skin 2 to 3 times a day while in the hospital. We will be watching for symptoms of infection daily. If you are heavier or diabetic, you will be at higher risk for wound infections. Sometimes you may be asked to lose weight or get better control of your blood sugar prior to transplant to reduce this risk. Ureter complications can include leaking at the site of the connection, or the connection can scar down and become too tight for urine to pass through. This is known as stenosis. Bladder complications can occur when you have difficulties with urination after transplant. A variety of issues can occur, such as bladder spasms, which can be painful or irritating, frequent urination, urinary incontinence, urinary retention, which may require catheterization, or the urine stream may be blocked by a large prostate. Most, but not all, urinary and bladder complications can be managed with treatment that doesn't require repeat operation. Hernias can occur after open kidney transplant due to the location of the incision, being overweight, or requiring immunosuppression. To prevent this, you may be required to lose weight prior to surgery, be given an abdominal binder to wear to reduce strain on the wound, and you will not be able to do any strenuous activity or lifting anything greater than 10 pounds for 2 to 3 months after transplant. At the end of 1 year, our expected patient and graft survival is approximately 95 to 97%. At the time of transplant, you will start anti-rejection medications through an IV in the operating room. You will need to take anti-rejection medications by mouth twice daily for as long as you have the transplant. You'll start with larger doses, and these doses will taper down over the first 3 to 6 months after transplant. These medications have side effects. Most commonly, they cause GI upset, diarrhea, skin and hair changes. One of these medications we give you is called tacrolimus. This medication must be kept within a certain range. If it is too low, you will get rejection. And if the dose is too high, certain side effects like headaches, shaking, and even seizures can occur. Overall, these medications reduce your body's ability to fight infection and cancer. It is very important to learn from patients already living with transplant how to live safely in your community. After transplant, you will need your support people. They will help you with everything from your discharge instructions, medications, transportation, to attending your clinic visits with you. You won't be able to lift anything heavier than 10 pounds, so you'll need help with laundry, dishes, cooking, and other daily activities. You'll be able to shower, but no baths, hot tubs, or swimming pools are allowed after transplant. You'll be able to take a bath once your incision is completely healed. You'll be attending clinic about twice weekly for the first couple months after transplant. When things become more stable, you will see us less and less. plan to take about 3 months off if you're working. We want to answer all of your questions to help you move forward with confidence toward the day of your transplant. Please don't hesitate to reach out for any reason as we move through the process. Thank you for watching and for choosing Henry Ford Health for your care.